Hey Joe, what's up?
Hey man, how's it going?
I'm just at the park, chilling.
Hey listen, I know you just left the house, but there are no more cookies in this jar, and I never got one.
Okay.
So how many did you eat?
Are you saying you think I ate all of them?
Well, you must have. I didn't get any, and now all 12 are gone.
I mean, I ate a few of them, sure, but all of them? Come on, man.
All right, but how many exactly did you eat?
You want me to go through every cookie I ate?
Yes.
I mean, it seems a little pedantic. I mean, I can
it's
do it.
It's not pedantic. I want
to. I don't know why you're having to go into
all.
This whole thing. It's just a couple cookies. There were a couple I ate on the drive home after I picked them up.
Chip in my cookie dough.
I used one as an energy boost on my daily jog.
On my stereo.
There were the Target practice one.
Four and five.
Around, I never feel so low.
I ate one while I was writing this song.
Not a question, baby.
I wanted to see what would happen if you drove over one of them.
You got me going crazy, think I'm out of my mind.
Then there were the three I ate during that David Leitch movie.
8, 9,
come
and 10.
Come on, give me a sign.
And I had one as a bedtime snack.
In the rough, girl, you're one of a kind.
That's only 11, though. Are you sure you didn't eat any more?
Look, I'm telling you, man, that was the last one I ate. Well, I...
Oh dear God.
Yeah, I guess I was just suppressing that memory.
Well, you owe me a jar of cookies.
Look, I'll buy you a box of cookies next time I see you, okay?
See ya. Having rewatched David Leitch's Bullet Train, I have to say, I am much more impressed the second time around. With a runtime of 2 hours and 7 minutes, this film wastes no time introducing its 7 principal characters: the Father, Ladybug, Lemon, Tangerine, the White Death, the Prince, and the Elder.
Upon first watch, this film seems to be nothing more than lazy storytelling and cheap tricks, constantly using luck and fate to explain away the strange occurrences throughout. And while much of the film's bizarre coincidences are never rationalized, I posit that this isn't the point. Luck is not the theme of this movie, but merely a storytelling device to facilitate this film's true theme.
This is not a story about fate, but about fathers.
Part 1, the recap. First, this movie is visually stunning. From its creatively choreographed fight scenes to its wonderfully vibrant style, Bullet Train was the kind of movie to see in the theaters. Taking place nearly entirely on a train, the audience never gets bored with the scenery as we constantly shift through an anthology of stories about each character. Throughout, it tells the stories of 6 different assassins, all but one of whom die by the end. Oh, spoilers by the way. The film opens with an introduction of the father, a deadbeat dad who let his son be pushed off a roof. He is told by his father, later revealed as the Elder, that a father's job is to protect his family. Manipulated by the prince into thinking his son's offender is on a certain train, he hurriedly makes his way to avenge his son. We then follow Brad Pitt's character, Ladybug, as he gets on this same train to steal a silver briefcase full of money. We are told that this is the ransom money for the White Death's son, and, coincidentally, the payment for his assassination. As the events of the film play out, we learn more and more about a character known as the White Death, a power-hungry mob boss who seeks revenge on all the people who had a hand in his wife's death. I don't want to veer too off to explain every character's motivation and reasoning for being on the train, but they were all essentially hired by the White Death to kill each other. One other character I would like to mention is the Prince, a spoiled girl who never got the attention of her father, the White Death, and plans to murder him. Throughout the film, she constantly talks about her luck in life, and her plans keep working out, sometimes miraculously, in her favor. Her highly lucky character is juxtaposed with Ladybug's self-proclaimed unlucky character. But I'll come back to this. Part 2, Two Fathers.
Although many dichotomies run throughout this film, there is one that I'd like to focus on. The dichotomy of two fathers, the Elder and the White Death.
Both are very similar upon first glance, but in the end separated by the fruit of their actions. Both lost their wives because of their work. Both have children who want their affection. Both are old men who have had to live with the choices they've made. Yet only one of them protects their family, only one of them takes responsibility for their actions, and only one of them survives. The White Death neglects to love his children, and the result of this neglect is a disappointing son that he hires an assassin to kill, and a narcissistic daughter that desires to kill him. The elder saves his grandson from the plans of the prince, and is shown to care very much for his son and family. The main theme of this movie is contained in a sort of throwaway line. I actually missed it on first viewing. It's a line spoken by Tangerine to Lemon during their recount of the number of people they killed rescuing the White Death's son. Concerning an innocent bystander who ran up to the car before it exploded.
That wasn't our fault. No.
Well, what did Thomas the Tank Engine say, Lemon?
That's really mean.
SAA, take responsibility, mate.
Take a little responsibility. There are good and bad fathers. What separates the two is that one takes responsibility, and the other blames the world. In a climactic moment with the White Death standing atop the Elder, gun pointed at his head, Kimura throws the water bottle, cue eye roll, at the White Death to save his father. Suddenly, we see that the Elder's efforts to take responsibility for his family, as a good father does, is what saves him in the end. And what once was spoken as a rebuke is said again in pride, spoken to Kimura, the Elder says, a father protects his family. In Japanese culture, a child is not only responsible to provide for their children, but their parents too. This is at the root of this film's most potent message, that active love and honor are more powerful than any luck you do or do not possess. The Elder led the way for his son to learn what it means to be a father. He protected his grandson and protected his son. There is a scene where Lemon suspects Kimura and the prince of being a diesel. At gunpoint, a choice must be made, to live and expose the evil plans of the prince, or to die and save his son. It is in this moment that Kimura, dubbed the father, learns what it means to be a father, and it chooses death so his son will live. The elder's efforts have not been in vain, and we see the direct effects of a father who protects his family. The luck of the prince was not enough to overcome the active love of the father. Part 3. Why use luck?
At the beginning of this essay, I mentioned that luck is not a theme of this movie, but merely a storytelling device to facilitate this film's true theme.
I argue that it doesn't matter that we are often told by the writers to suspend our disbelief, because it is through this device of luck that we see how two different characters respond to it. Looking at luck or fate as a symbol for the world, we discover that the elder never blames the world or fate for his troubles, but accepts the responsibility it takes to be a father and decides to move with fate, not against it. In contrast, we see the White Death neglect to love his children and blame 6 different people for the troubles in his life. Speaking to the elder before the final fight scene, he says,
"Yeah, children, you do the best you can to raise them right."
He fails to thoroughly examine the ruthlessness of his character. He does not see that his determination to achieve his goals, with no regard for those he is supposed to love and sacrifice for, is what ultimately leads to his demise.
This film is trying to tell us that fathers, parents, and leaders in general must take responsibility for the choices they've made to enable the next generation of fathers, parents, and leaders to grow and teach their children to live as people full of honor and committed to love at any cost. There is no amount of luck that can overcome the activity of love. We'll see you in the next video.
You're the chocolate chip in my cookie dough. You're a brand new record on my stereo. Every time you come around.